Please, I'll call the names, and when you come forth, I am expecting our photographer, our photographers to be ready with their cameras. Hallelujah. Okay.
The first
name I want to call is Sister Geltris. Hallelujah. Next person is Cynthia Zakaria. Hallelujah. She's not here. Okay. Hallelujah, celebrate Jesus. Hallelujah, the next person is Rejoice Zachariah. Rejoice, hallelujah. That's the greatest testimony. It's more than having a house, it's more than having a car. Aris Ryan Ashu. Aris. Oh, yes. Next person, Sister Edwish.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have Lloyd. Hallelujah. Smile.
He wants to disappear.
Hallelujah. The next person is Laris. Laris, hallelujah. Celebrate Master Jesus.
Divine, hallelujah, I pray Jesus.
Questions that we will answer now. The first question someone asked, can I date a man? Take your Bibles because you have been giving some verses and then you read it. It says, can I date? Now, you are in a church where they don't only teach you Bible, they teach you sense. Hallelujah. They not only teach you Bible, we teach you sense. They are people anointing them, put oil on them, let them turn like chicken and chips. Once you tell them they are getting married tomorrow, the man will come and they will drive that man with their own mouth.
Amen.
Wisdom is profitable. So we don't only teach you Bible, we teach you common sense.
Amen.
That is needed. Sense, God, it does not matter how I pray for you for your husband, you have to still meet the husband and behave yourself. And what you need to behave yourself is, you will not be preaching Bible. It's sense, you need common sense. You need to learn that when you are with him for the first day, you don't need to talk too much. Because some men don't like too much talk. Bible will not teach you that. They will teach you that. Can I date a man who don't go in my church? Or can I date a man who don't attend my church? Of course, yes. You can date a man who don't attend your church. The last marriage we had, the gentleman was not here. He only came now and again. Now, we don't, again, I keep saying it, we don't care about the numbers. Sir. The numbers will definitely come. Some places you go, they'll say, no, one just a man from the church so that nobody leaves the church. No, sir. Nobody brought anyone here. The Bible says, you came in because God brought you in.
Yes,
so we should not make you a slave telling you, oh, you should only date a man from this church. I told you last week, it's the same thing with business. It's the same thing with money. Now, you actually come here to receive favor to go out there and get the job easily. The same thing with husband, the same thing with wife. You must not locate them here. As you come here, as you go out there with the favor you receive from here, husband will locate you. Job will locate you. Business will locate you. Helpers will locate you. It must not always be from your environment. Of course, you can date a man out of this church. But the only problem we always face is counseling becomes difficult. The last counseling was the simplest counseling we had whatsoever. Because if the man
man is from another church and they have different beliefs, there's a conflict there. You'll be saying, oh, we don't do baptism. We have people here come and say, we don't do baptism. We have people here come and say, we don't take communion. We have people here come and say, we don't speak in tongues. So if they are in that kind of a place and then you want to get married to them, how do we do the counseling? It becomes difficult. That's the only thing. But apart from that, we'll always look for a way. We are not worried about after your marriage, you can go with him, go wherever you want to go. That's fine. So you can get a man out of this place. Hallelujah.
Amen.
For how long can I take to get married after dating? How long? Mama, do you have anything to say? How long will it take me if I'm dating a man? How long will it take me to get married to the man? Well, at the end of the day, whoever asks this question is a lady, I believe so. You are not the one proposing marriage, he's the one proposing marriage. But at World Fire Ministry, we say after 6 months, it is okay for us to do another 6 months counseling. That's a year, and then you get married. If a man is with you for 5 years and he has not proposed to you, run. He's wasting your time.
Amen.
He's waiting for Jesus to come before he proposes to you.
Yeah,
waiting for time. He's occupying a space that someone else would have occupied. So you don't, what do you need to know about a woman for 5 years? The color of her skin, or where she came from, or what do you need to know? 5 years. You want to go for a degree course to know about, no. I suggest any real man will tell you from day one that this is my plan.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Where there's no vision, the people perish. Come on, I have something to say. Where there's no vision, what? The people.
Hallelujah.
The man is the prophet, is the priest, is the pastor of the house. So he should lay down his vision. When I met her, I said to her, I said, it's coming. I was just a student, though. But I said to her, I said, it's coming a time when I'll be traveling so much. I said, are you ready for this? She was not okay at the time. But now she can say, travel and go anywhere. She will say, don't even come back. Hallelujah. So the reason why we say that is because if I meet Teshen, for example, and I say, Teshen, I want to marry you, and then that's an example. And then I don't have a vision laid out of Teshen, and then she gets married to me without a vision. Now, when the vision comes after the marriage, and then I go back to Teshen, I say, Teshen, God just called me, I'm supposed to be a pastor. Hey-o. She will run away because that's not what she advocated for. Does that make sense?
Yes,
sir. Mama, carry on.
No, I wanted to say that 5 years is a lot. 5 years is a lot. The maximum, that means you have crossed the bridges, is 2. Because after 1 year maximum, the man should know whether I want to settle you or not. He should give you a plan. Even whether it's money or whatever is a hindrance, you should know after 1 year. And what's the plan? 5 years is too much. That's a time waster. Don't give that man 5 years and then after the 5 years,
he tells you, I'm going to marry another man.
Yeah, you're not good enough for me, so it's a time waster.
After you suffer with him for that 5 years. So you are only better, you are only palatable to suffer. You are not palatable to enjoy.
Just to mention one other thing that you said about vision. What we should know, for example, maybe you married a man and both of you were unbelievers. And then now you've come to Christ, but the man wants to serve Christ, but that's not what you advocated for. That was not the original vision. What do you do?
No, ma, let's focus on this one. We are going to another question already now.
No, that is the point you said about vision.
What did you say? I'm thinking it's another question altogether.
It was from what you said. You said that a man should have a vision and tell the woman, because if the woman comes in and she cannot withstand the man's vision, then she will run away.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm saying that if they got married, probably as unbelievers or maybe as just Christian brothers, but in the course of the marriage, the man had a revelation that he has to serve God on a higher level than they were meant to, and the woman was not ready, what does she do?
She prays. Marriage is better for us. But once you are in there, there's no going out. How can we manage a situation where you did not find a husband in the presence of God? Was that your question? How can we manage a situation where you did not find a husband in the presence of God? It's your husband. You go, many, the problem is that many of us don't pray. Many of us don't do what? We don't pray. we will complain, we will back him, we will mock him, we will shout, we will be angry, but we don't pray about it. You pray, God answers prayers. 1 Corinthians 7, quickly, let's look at this. 1 Corinthians 7:12. Thank you, Major, for helping us with the projector. He says what? But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any brother had a wife that believeth not, does that make sense? And she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her. Let's look at the next verse. Verse 13. It says, and the woman which had a husband that believed, we've had this question so many times, that believeth not. As long as you are really there, you are there. Whether he believes or he doesn't believe, he says, what? And if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. Verse 14, he says, what? For the unbelieving husband is sanctified, what? By the wife. And so it means as you are going down on your knees and he can see Christ in you, he will give his life to Christ.
Hallelujah.
Automatically.
Amen.
The problem with many, for example, women is that they will begin to nagging. When, who has nagging help? When you nag a man, what you do is you push him out. You push him out. And he will go out there and meet someone else who doesn't nag him. That's the truth about it. He says, be satisfied by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is satisfied by the husband. Same thing with the husband. So if your wife is not okay, and you just have to pray, that's all. Is satisfied by the husband, else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. Verse 15, he says, but if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God has called us to peace. So do whatever you can do to make peace in the first instance. Does that make any sense? The next question is, a man husband that doesn't work and doesn't bother to look for one for work, and you can respect him? He's at home eating all your food. Can you respect him? It's a marriage. If your husband doesn't work or your wife doesn't work, help them and pray for them. Like I said, the main thing here is spirituality. Many of us don't go down on our knees, but we know how to complain. Our mouth is sharper to talk, but our mouth is not sharper to pray. God gave you that mouth not to talk, not to be arrogant or to shout at your man or your wife, but to pray. Your mouth is given to you to pray. Say, open down that mouth and I will fill it in. Hallelujah. Now, a real man, I wrote here, is an individual who welcomes responsibility. This thing you say, you know, 50-50, I don't believe in 50-50. I've never gone out with my wife as a thing. Difficult. I don't believe in 50-50. The man is responsible to take care of his wife. You might not like that. A man is built like a bodybuilder, sir. Look at me, sir. A man is built like a bodybuilder. The more weight he puts on that muscle, the bigger the muscle.
Yes,
so a man has been designed to accept responsibility.
Yes.
You meet a man and he doesn't accept responsibility, you go out for a meal and he say, pay 20 pounds, pay 20 pounds, wrong.
Yeah.
So we are in Europe, push Europe. God created us like bodybuilders. So men are created to respond naturally to crisis.
Hallelujah.
Naturally. There are many times we have a problem and there are thousands of pounds I need to add. And there's no 50-50. I'll just pay for it.
There's
no 50-50.
That's it. Gentlemen.
That's me. My marriage will not be your marriage. Does that make any sense? He works for you, carry on like that, but that's what I will do.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Anytime you give your wife something, God will give you back.
Yeah.
More.
Right,
amen. If there are men in this house, say
hallelujah.
What I have to say again is, Adam had a job before God united him. Does that make sense? Adam had what? Adam was busy doing his job, and then God said, no, it's not right for Adam to be alone, and he created a wife. So a man is supposed to have a job, but in an instant when he doesn't have, please support them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Support them and pray for the job. Many of us support and we still talk with our mouth. We'll support, we'll give food and we abuse. It doesn't work like that. Remember the Bible verses we just read. They say your holiness should change the man. is you see God in you. Not that when there's a problem, you say, I'm the one that does everything in this house. No. No. It doesn't work like that. Shout hallelujah. First Timothy 5:8. Let's look at that. First Timothy 5:8. Quickly. We don't have the time. First Timothy 5:8. Always pray for your husband every day. That should be your responsibility as a wife. It says what? But we know that the law is good. First Timothy 5:8. It says, but if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he had denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. Now, if the guy is not working, please support him till he gets a job. Hallelujah. Support him, pray for him till he gets a job. Don't only talk. Many of us talk. You are just here eating my food, then we don't pray. If you pray for that guy, you'll get a job. Do you believe prayers?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Are we getting some knowledge here? Talking about vision in the marriage, what do you really mean by what is a man's vision? Vision is literally the plan of God for that man. We said that already. So when a man meets you and he's telling you, I like you, many of us don't understand. When we see a man in the morning, we go for a date in the afternoon. The next thing we are talking about is marriage. And many of us get it wrong as well. You meet a man, and because he is born on the same birthday like you, and you say, the conversation was so alright. Everything is so fine. We just flow. That's how you flow in the river. That is not a confirmation that that's the right man. What did he tell you on the day that you're so happy? Date of birth? For him, we are the same horoscope. People just go into the world. He said, "We are. I'm cancer. Is cancer. Those are things of the world. We are not chatting things of the world. We are in this world, but none of this is wrong." So that the conversation flow is not a nugget or a guarantee that that's the right man for you. It does not make any sense to anyone. Proverbs 29:18. It says, "Where there's no vision, the people perish." Same with marriage. If a man does not have a vision for you, that marriage will sink. So when you meet a man, go on a date with them. Let them. If a man is talking less, they run away. If he's not married to you and he's talking less, when he's married to you, he will not talk. When there are things to sort out, he'll be quiet. I'm not making any sense. This is wisdom I'm giving you. He should be able to tell you everything. Like my wife will say, he should tell you if he has debts to pay. He should tell you what his plans are for this relationship in the next 10 years. Does that make any sense to you? If you have children, he should be able to tell you what he's planning for the children. There should be, everything should be on the table, nothing excluded. Hallelujah. Now the next one is being a second wife a sin before God? If yes, what about Solomon that married more than one wife? He says, because I heard you say that marriage is, not me, it's one mama who said it. I heard you say that marriage is for one man and one woman. Hallelujah. Mama, do you have something to say before I say? Genesis 1:26, let's read. Genesis 1:26. The Bible is a standard for living. Genesis 1:26, says what? And God said, let's read together. Let us make man in our image after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the surface of the earth. Hallelujah. Next one. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, created he him. Male. Created he. Adam and Eve. Not Adam and Steve. Not Adam and Rebecca and Jocelyn. Male and created one man and one. No wife. Wife. Hallelujah. Am I making any sense?
Yes, sir.
Now God is the author of marriage and he got it right there. If God gets it right, it means his standards are what we have to follow. Genesis 2:23-24, quickly. Genesis 2:23-24, quickly. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called because she was taken out of. She shall be called, or they shall be called wife. Is that what it says? She shall be called, so is one. Hallelujah. Polygamy is man-made idea. Yes. And if you look very keenly, every relationship or every family that is polygamous, always chaos. In the Bible, Solomon had what, 700 wives, 300 concubines. He ended up leaving God. So the women took him away from God. And God is a jealous. Anything that takes you away from God, run away from it. Hallelujah. If you look all throughout the Bible, every polygamous marriage, there were always problems. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do we have anything to add to that? 1 Kings 11:3. He says, and he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. I believe Solomon slept one today, slept one again next 2 years. So there was always fighting among the women. Who is next? Contention. Mama, if you have anything to say, say.
Not really. At the end of the day, why would you want to be a second class citizen when you can be first class?
Can you imagine?
Why would you want to be a second class citizen when you can be your own princess? So people are even glad to say, I just want to be his baby mama. Why would you want to be somebody's baby mama when you can be the princess in the
room? Exactly.
So find your own man. There's a man for every woman. I said there last time, I said, my mom always told me, he said that the world will tell you there are more men, there are more women than men. But she said to me, if you make yourself a wife, there are less wives and there are more men.
Yeah.
So there are more men looking for wives, not women.
Yeah.
So you bring yourself up to that level and you have more men looking for you. There is a man for every woman.
Amen.
Do not go looking for another woman's man.
Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Then there are religions that accept polygamy, hallelujah. We are talking here in the sense of Christianity. How do you deal with someone's partner who will date you for 5 years? This is more like the same questions. And but yeah, does not want to marry you. We've answered that already. Run away. Say run. Or ask him. Sit down and ask him, what is your plan? What is your vision for this relationship? And if he's saying nothing, it means he is offering nothing. Does that make sense, everyone? Is it necessary to have a girlfriend? I need to draw the youth's ears. Is it necessary to get a girlfriend? If you are youth in here, youth is from 12 till 21. 21, if you are still going to school, forget about girlfriend. Face your book. Face what? Your book. I'm talking to the youth. I'll have a meeting with them after service. Face your books. Having a girlfriend is not a sin. Okay? But as long as you are ready for marriage. As long as you are ready. So if you know you are ready for marriage, go ahead. Because when pregnancy comes, we'll join you two together. Some of the youth are already smiling. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because what we are saying that is, it will be a distraction.
It's true.
It will be what? A distraction. Because you are not ready for marriage. You just want to catch fishes. You are not ready for marriage. So why go into something you are not ready for? Because anything can happen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What if before you were born again, you have a child, and you are in the presence, and the child's dad is not in the presence, and asks you to marry you, what do you say to him? Because you have kids together, do you say yes or no? That you have kids with someone does not necessarily mean you must get married to them.
Amen.
That you have kids with someone does not necessarily mean you should get married to them. I've told you, Genesis 24, don't marry just because you have kids. I've said that really. The truth is, if you married an unbeliever, the devil will be your father-in-law. Hallelujah. Now, if he is the one you like and he likes you, why not? Go ahead and get married. Hallelujah. If he likes you and you know this is who God wants me to get married to, go ahead and get married. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Mark, I don't think we are taking any questions. Is it a sin not to pay my tithe? It's not a sin. Hallelujah. Is it a sin not to pay But it's not a sin. No, it's fine, let's take it. Is it a sin not to pay? It is not a sin. But there are levels financially that you may never enter. I remember when I was not a tither, my wife is here. Every time she was in Italy, I'll be calling her, my nose is running, my leg is, I was not a believer then. Well, I'm giving my life, taking it back. But I had about 4 or 5 accidents a year. And all the accidents, my car was a write-off, complete write-off. When the police had all came to the scene, they said, how did you get out of this town? But as soon as I became born again and I started paying my tithe, my wife is here, I have never had one accident.
Hallelujah.
Let's read Malachi 3, 6 to 11. Malachi 3, 6 to 11. You judge for yourself. Hallelujah. It says what? For I am the Lord, I change not. Before or now, I change. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. Verse 7. This is a topic we don't talk about yet. It says, even from the days of your fathers, you have gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, said the Lord of hosts. But he said, wherein shall he return? The next verse, verse 8, he says what? He says, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithe and offering. Many of you want to go to town? Who will shop? Then on Sunday, we'll look at the corner of our bag where they are the yellow coins. That's what we'll take and give for offering. It says verse 8, will a man rob God? Verse 9, please. You are, no, I don't even want to read all that. Hallelujah. The simple truth is, if it works for you, do it. It works for you. Hallelujah. Yeah. Do you have anything to say?
There's another off my head. There's a verse in the Bible that says, people who shall not make heaven. It talked about lesbians, it talked about sinners, and it talked about robbers. The verse Papa has just read says what? You have robber means you are a thief with an arm. I'm not saying anything, or you judge for yourself. If they say robbers cannot make heaven, and then the Bible is saying here that you have robbed me, what does that mean?
Your mama is so wrong. Tithing, you pay or you don't pay, is not a sin. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now my next question. Can I be prophesied? Me, I don't tell people pay your tithe. Never. You come to me, Pastor, what do you say about tithing? As I pray for you in the name of Jesus, get revelation. Let your eyes open. And 99% will come back and say, Papa, I just heard God say to me, clearly pay your tithe. Pastor Isaac, yeah, he's one of them. Maybe he's another one. God will speak to you himself.
Eh?
What is not true?
It's the sin for me. It's a sin.
Okay, I'm the head of word and fire ministry. It is not a sin. Either. Can I be prophesied upon and it does not happen? If yes, why? Can I be prophesied upon and it does not happen? If not, why? Okay. Now, many will not tell you the prophecy that came through in the first place. Hallelujah. There's someone who came to me and I prophesied. The first one, you were there, it happened. Just like you said, went back and everything was fine. God did the miracle. Now, another one came. There are some prophecies that happen instanto. There are other prophecies that you have a work to do. You have a part to play. Hallelujah. The important thing, first of all, is to distinguish between a prophecy and advice. Many of you come to me, even when I'm prophesying, I'll say, I see. You should listen. Now, spiritual things are very slippery. Many times you come to me, I am giving you an advice on what to do. I'm not prophesying to you. But because you're a prophet, they'll always say you are prophesying. There are some things I will say by our faith work. Go now, it will happen. It's not prophecy. I am saying that out of my faith. say that out of the scriptures that says in Luke 1:37, therefore without God nothing shall be impossible. In this kingdom, I give you an assignment, you come back to me and say, I could not do it. I just put you aside. Because this kingdom is not a kingdom of those who give up. This kingdom is a kingdom of those who must make it happen. Prophecy without fervent prayer equals delay. The chain is required in prophecy. Judges 6, 12, 16. Let's look at this quickly. Judges 6, 12, 16. One thing you must understand is that doubt kills prophecy. People come to my office and I'll tell them, this is what God is saying. They'll go and do their own. And when he fails, they'll come back with another bigger problem. Many of you even go ahead and say, Papa, you said no, that's not what I said. Someone came in the office and I said, he says, I want to go to Canada. And the problem also is that we have so many voices we are hearing. Many of you sitting looking at me now, you have other prophets you are consulting. So when I say my own, you consult the other prophet and they confuse your head. Many times because of the simplicity of the man of God, the one you are not seeing, you respect him more. Someone came to me and said, Pastor, I will give you money to buy sugar. I'm not calling the person's name. It's not right. Does that make sense? He could have bought sugar. I don't drink tea. I don't drink coffee. But I took the money and said, okay, I'll buy you sugar. Even you, God in heaven, what will be thinking? Some things I will not correct you. You will learn. Common sense is not. Some things I will not say anything. Give me, I'll buy you sugar. Sugar that I don't drink. You are the one drinking sugar. I should be the one to buy you sugar. Can you do that to your father? Doubt kills prophecy. He came to me and he said, I'm going to Canada. I said, you did not tell me you're going to Canada. I said, I held his hand. Many times when I hold your hands, I'm connected. I said, let's pray in the name of Jesus. And I said, God just said, don't go to Canada. Now, he has heard from another prophet that you should go to Canada. I said, if you go to Canada, things will not work out. I said, there's a team here for you. Stay here. Now, when you say that to many people, the thing is because you want them to come to church. Because he heard from another prophet that he should go to Canada. He went to Canada. He almost died in Canada. He was in the hospital for almost 4 weeks. And that operation in the hospital was meant to take about 8, 9, 10 weeks. And then recovery was about to take about 3 months. So we're looking at 6 months. Who did they call again? It's still me. He called and then we prayed. And then after 4 weeks, he was out of the hospital. And then even to come back was a problem. But by prayer, he finally came back and he had a team just where I said he should have a team. So many times familiarity always comes in the way. Your prophecy will delay. I don't have much time. God said to the children of Israel that you, children of Israel, you will be in captivity for 400 years. Let's read quickly. Legade.
Amen.
No, Judges 6, 12. Come back to that. But let's read Judges 6, 12. Say what? And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord be with you, thy mighty man. Oh, value, verse 13. Right, the next verse. He says, and Gideon said unto him, oh, my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then, look, he's arguing with an angel. An angel is bringing a message. He's arguing with an angel. What's that? Unbelief. Doubt. Hallelujah. Genesis 15, 13. Quickly. We don't have the time. Genesis 15, 13. Genesis 15, 13, what does it say? And he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them for, that's God speaking, you know, say my own people, they will afflict them better. So they afflict them for what? 400 years. Now let's read Exodus 12, 40. Exodus 12, 40. Exodus 12, 40. It says what? Now the sojourning of the children of Israel, that's the fulfillment of prophecy, who dwell in Egypt was what? 430 years. How many years did God say to stay in bondage? How many years did they stay in bondage? Did God lie? came here and I gave her a prophecy and I said, this is what, it was not even a prophecy, I gave her an advice. She has been in a relationship for more than 6 years. Now they've been in the relationship. They are not married. The guy is not saying anything. And suddenly they had a problem. And I said to her, I said, go and speak, because he's not speaking. He will not, they have a problem, he's not talking. She's not talking. Someone must speak now. Someone must be mature enough to say, no, let's solve this. And I said, go and say to him, let's talk about it. It was not a prophecy. Prophecy, you guys understand, prophecy is predicting the future. Now as I'm talking to you, I hear a name, Christine. That's prophecy. There's someone here, I know there's no one here called Christine, but your family member may be called Christine. Anyone here with a family member, Christine? Okay, who is Christine? That's prophecy. Did you tell me that? It is not some, I see a name ending with G-O-N-G-P-E-D. I see Bonaberry. What is Bonaberry to you?
It's the time where she lives.
We did not discover.
Hallelujah!
I go ahead again and say something profound. I traveled to Adamawa. Do you know anything about Adamawa? What is Adamawa to you? Someone put the microphone in their mouth now. Where are these people? Now, that is prophecy. That is what prophecy. And if I want to pray for her, I will say, thou sayest the Spirit of the Lord. Now, prophecy can be for a time. I can say, by this time next year. Does that make sense? Or I cannot say anything. Or I can say, I see someone is sick. Pray. I did this, not prophecy. I only saw and I said, pray. I did not pray for you. But this one, I'm telling her exactly. I traveled to a place called, what is Pharaoh? Pharaoh, Egypt. Go and find out. It's a division in that. Are you from a Muslim? You get it?
I'm not from the Muslim, but Adamawa is where my father's small sister lives. She passed all her life there. And my mother also, her father comes from a Muslim part.
So prophecy is predicting the future. I see help coming to your mother. That's prophecy. That is what?
That's
now I'm just giving her a prayer. Many times I will say that and I will say someone is sick. For example, I can just go to her. I say someone is healing your family. So we have not discussed. Who is honoring? Honoring. Put the microphone. Who is honoring?
My late uncle's wife.
Where is she?
She's in somewhere in Western Province.
Cameroon. She needs healing in her body.
She's been
healed
for a while.
We did not discuss that. That's prophecy. Now I can go ahead and say, in the name of Jesus, she is healed and she will be healed. That's prophecy. Prophecy is not I see. Prophecy is not advice. When I say that now, she has a prayer for. She'll go now and pray for that lady. I'm talking about the power of God is over me. She can go now and pray for that lady. So we should differentiate between advice and prophecy. I don't have time for that. Hallelujah. What to do when prophecy says this man is my husband, but we don't see the said man like a suitable husband? What do you do if for example, I tell you that this man is my husband? This man is my husband. What am I doing? Okay. Let's say I prophesy to her and I say this is the husband. And she does not see him like a husband. What do you do? I'll tell you something. You know the last marriage you had? I spoke to her personally. And I said to her, I said, the man who is coming to you will not like him. You know, especially women, you know how to choose. You know how to. I said, the man who is coming, you don't like him. And guess what? The man came. And she came to me and said, Papa, it's true. I don't like, it's not my type of man. You know, it's not my type. He's not tall. It's not my type of man. Now they haven't even gone up again. It's not my type. She's not considering spirituality. She's not considering where he is. No. She's considering only the look, physical look. Hallelujah. Depend on what you call it. I don't know what you call suitable man. Women are so complicated in their choice of a man. There is nothing like a perfect man. I am the most complicated. If you doubt me, ask my wife. Complicate. Hallelujah. Complicate me. What do you do when prophecy says this man? Mama, answer. Your husband. Then you don't see the same man, your husband. Now when that happened, I was like advising her, let's pray about it. At one point we prayed, we fasted, God spoke, we prayed, we fasted, God spoke. Many times again we talk, we don't pray. God will never give you anything that looks like what is your will, what you like. God will never give you a pastor that you like. Many people have left here because they are older than me. No problem. We'll see. Peter was 47, Jesus was 30, and Peter called Jesus Master. Anointing of God on the life of a man of God has no respect for age. Mama, if you have anything to say, say let's carry on. The time is already far gone.
As long as you are, that was the true prophet of God that gave you that prophecy. God can never go wrong. God can never.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That man came and you guys did not work on what you were supposed to work. You didn't pray. Hallelujah.
No prophecy. Any prophecy without direction. Is an incantation. Okay? Any prophecy without a direction is what? An incantation. God said to them, forget about the weapons they are carrying. He said, just go there and dance. Prophecy giving that you have victory and give them direction. Sir, until they follow direction. Any prophecy, and I'll tell you something, people are running up and down looking for prophecy. No one prophecy PO. People are running up and down looking for prophecy. That a man can prophesy does not mean he has grace.
Oh.
Christian, who did this to you? Saul prophesied, was he a prophet? That a man is prophesying does not mean he has
grace.
God said to me, teach them my word. Let the word enter them. When the word enters you, you start prophesying by yourself.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
How can I know this is Mr. Right? We said already. Hallelujah. We said already. How can I know this is Mr. Right? Go for a day to dig him, know his vision, know his plans, get to know him. We said that the fact that he's talking things that you like does not mean. So we will say he makes me laugh. So he has six bank. His banks are six, but the bank account is not bank. That's how you enter family, you marry because of six bank and you suffer. No, this is very important what we're doing here. Hallelujah. I think that's all for the questions. If you have any other questions, we'll do it again next week and then we'll answer again next week. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In someone blessed. Let's take our offering and then carry on the service quickly. We have just 30 minutes to get out of this place.
Hallelujah. It's offering time. Hallelujah. Please let's be on our feet. If you have your envelopes, take them, lift them up and begin to send them on an errand.
Take our testimonies quickly.
Hallelujah.
One or two should be enough.
Okay. Because of time, we'll just take two, if it's okay.
Okay.
We'll see how it goes. But then, I'll call on my sister, my brother Sam. Hallelujah. Praise brother Sam. Okay. Sam's so, yeah. So we'll take the next. Sister Rejoice.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Celebrate Jesus. Celebrate Jesus.
Amen.
Friday, I had a chest pain. It was so painful, so I couldn't even breathe. Like when I was breathing, I was feeling a lot of pain. And then like, I was drinking a lot of anointing oil and the blood of Jesus. I thought maybe it would go away. And it didn't go away. And then I told Papa. And then Papa said, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are healed.
Amen.
It became a doubt because he just said, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are healed. But then I told him, like, I will pray. And then...
What are you praying again?
And then I didn't feel like praying by that. And then when Mibu just came and just said, like, you know, when we can go out together, why not to pray to God all together? And then we sat and we'll pray something like 3 hours. It was not me, but she said, like, let's pray, and then we'll pray something like 3 hours. When I was praying, the thing kept on coming and coming and coming. But I just said, like, God, just heal me, because now I told Papa that I will pray, and as I'm going to pray, I hope that the pain will go away.
And the pain left her in the name of Jesus. Give them a microphone. Tell them, lift your hands to heaven. Try to sing a song. Lift your hands to heaven. Mama, come pray. Lift your hands to heaven. Thank you, my Father. Don't look at me, look at Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. When was the last time you read your Bible? Give them a microphone. If you lie, I'll know. When was the last time you read your Bible? When was the last time?
Last Sunday.
In church. It doesn't matter where you go. Go to the what you call the biggest prophet, soever. It's the same thing. It's the same anointing. You must do something to keep that deliverance. Hallelujah. Give the microphone. Father, in the name of Jesus, lift up your hands. Lamb of the tribe of Judah, I pray for the zeal, power of the Holy Ghost, all over her now. From the crown of her head to the sole of her feet, I declare the girl in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lion of the tribe of Judah, Maso Pade Katala Kata, Yekete Mayala Kato Lokose Mayakata, Lekokote Mayakata, fire of the Holy Ghost, all over her life. Fire of the Holy Ghost, from her head to her toe, fire. All over, from her head to her toe, right now. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, press touch now. Anything you find here that is not of you, take it out, take it out, take it out. That spirit of loopiness, that spirit of loopiness, Holy Ghost, right now, lift up your hands. Fire of the Holy Ghost, all over body, from our head to our toe. That spirit of loopiness, I command it to go now. I command it to go now. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It is God. In Jesus' name, amen. Next testimony, quickly, sir. I know you guys are looking out to fall.
Hallelujah. Celebrate it, Lord, as she comes. Sister Rita, as you ask her sick. Thank you, Jesus.
There was something that happened to me last week. Before I give the testimony, it was Apostle Smith that came here. That gave the prophecy that my job, I was going to lose my job. He prayed. 2nd of November, I was working. I met a lady. The lady needed attention. I think I did not give her.
That was when? That was last? What, a year ago?
Yeah. So 2nd of November, I was working. The lady came. She needed all the attention that she needed. I don't know what was going on with her.
You see now prophecy. It's given last year and it happened this year.
Yeah.
So someone will say after 2 months, he's just beginning.
When I did not give her what she wants, she flipped. And she used the word, me and my colleague, we were a waste of space. And something in me just flipped. Instead of me calming myself down, I did not like go to her, beating her up or something like that. But I just went to her, asking her a question. Like my hand that I showed in her face, why are you calling me that? it got me into trouble. I was there, they called me to the office. He said, interviews upon interviews. I went there twice, and the second time I met the lady that I am under her, hoping that, oh, she will even say something for me. Rather, she's the one even pouring the fire in for me to even get fired. She said to me, oh, what we saw was so bad, and my heart just went. I said, this is me that you guys are talking about. I worked so hard, so can't I find anyone to stand in for me? I come home. When I'm at work, my face is straight, I'm just working. But inside, I know something is going on. I'll come home, I'll cry, I'll pray, I'll call God. The day that I'm going, they said, oh, that's the final interview that will decide my fate, if I'm supposed to be there or not. So I said, okay. When I was going, I told Papa, I told Pastor David. That was when Sister Florence, her wedding. That's the day that I told him, Pastor David. So but I told Papa already. Then Papa prayed, and when I was going, I just said, Holy Spirit, you are the one that going with me, because now I don't have anyone. Those that I know that they will fight for me, they did not even do anything. So that made me realize that I'm not even wanted yet. So it's just you and me and you. If I lose my job, it is you. If I don't lose it, it's you. I got there, and my managers, two managers, overall managers, two of them, that I barely even speak to them. So when I got there, I saw them. The one that is my manager, overall manager, he said to them, he's not feeling well, so he can't come to the meeting. I said, okay. So it's me and those two. I said, okay. First, they did the interview, everything that so I'm supposed to tell them, and they've checked the three interviews that I've been comparing what I've said to them. So they realize that everything that I've said is the same thing that keep on repeating everything. So one of the managers said, okay, let's go and see the CCTV. We went there, me and other two, but I need to go with a colleague. There's this lady at my workplace that she always comes to me asking me how I am, and I said, okay, let me take it. I said, oh, I'll go with you. So we went there watching the CCTV. Apparently, I didn't do anything to the woman. The one that did something to the woman was my other colleague. She rather took the woman's bags that she came with the shopping, ended up throwing it at the woman, that I was not even there. All that I did was me, my hand that I was asking her, if I speak to you like that, will you be happy? So that was all that I did. So my manager was sitting down asking, so how come they did not see all these things? But her one that everybody's talking about it, he said, I don't know. I kept quiet, and we went to the room. So one of the managers was saying that, oh, it wasn't as serious as we were thinking that it was, because those that did the CCTV was the people that were telling the managers what has happened, and including my manager that I'm under her. And so I said, okay. So when they came back, they said, well, whatever that was said, it wasn't like that, because they said I was aggressive to the woman. But rather, it's the woman rather was aggressive to me and my colleague. That's why my colleague threw the bag at her. But I wasn't there with my colleague, so I wasn't even part of the whole thing. So they gave me a letter. I think 2 days later, they gave me a letter telling me that even though I knew about the rules in the company, that when a customer is angry, you're not supposed to approach her. And I ended up doing that. So because of that, it's not about how they were saying it, but they will give me a verbal warning that I will keep on keeping my job. So I'm standing here thanking God.
Thank Master Jesus.
Everything that
the verbal warning is deleted in their system in the name of Jesus. Anyone here that is set up at your job, it will backfire in the name of Jesus. Take one more and let's go, please.
Sam. Celebrate Jesus as Sam comes. Hallelujah.
I need to anoint Sam again for my personality.
Amen.
I just want to thank God because this week something happened. So on the first day,
someone phoned me for something to do for like the banks. So I just went into my account, and lo and behold, there was some money in there. I thought like it was money that, I don't know, because I thought there wasn't supposed to be anything in there. So I looked at the sum.
It's a huge amount. They just want to say so that someone should not come and ask me after service that I have this problem, I need urgent money.
Yeah.
Don't say the amount.
So to cut a long story short, I just want to thank God, because I don't know where that money came from.
Someone here, you testify the same testimony this week in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Supernatural money will land in your account in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I don't like that amen at all.
Amen.
Celebrate Master Jesus. Father, we thank you for this testimony. That is your hand, and Lord, we bless you. As I preach this short word, oh Lord, go ahead and do only what you alone can do. Deliver anyone that you need to deliver. Take all the glory in Jesus' name.
Amen.
No service has really started until the word of God has gone forth. I love the word of God because you cannot create any lasting thing without the word of God. Whatever the word of God gives you, it keeps it. Whatever you get by yourself, you take look for a way to keep it. Hallelujah. After now, the word of God will be speaking for you in the name of Jesus. That's why you saw me and asked her, when was the last time you read the word of God? So every time you read the word, you meditate on that word, that's why the prophet said it was like fire. Oh, you guys don't understand what you mean. Like what? Fire in the notes. The word of God is fire. The Bible says in Hebrews that the word of God is quick and powerful. Anything that you release the word of God upon, even if it's sickness, is death, whatever that is, the word of God goes and breaks through.
Amen.
You are not shouting amen because you don't understand.
Amen.
John 1:15, and that's the same story with 99% of us here. We don't hear the word on Sunday. We go about our normal activity, and then we say, oh, that prophecy is delayed. No, sir, there's something you must do. What you must do, you must open the Bible and use those words to pray. Jesus had to open the Bible, even Jesus had to open the Bible to find out what was written about him and what he had to do. Jesus, the Son of God.
Amen.
A day passes me by without reading the Bible, I feel empty.
Yes, sir.
I feel like that is a totally lost day. John 1:1-5 speaks about the word became flesh. In the beginning was
the word.
And the word was
God.
And the word was
God.
The word is God himself. So every time you read your Bible, you are filling your system with God.
Amen.
The more of God you have in you, the easier things become.
Amen.
Isaiah 10:27. It says, it shall come to pass in that day that the burden shall be lifted off their shoulder and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. The anointing of God is the word of God. So the more of that word you have in you, the easier you begin to break loose. You know why they chase you in your dreams? Because you go to bed without even reading the word of God. The word of God is fire in your homes. So every time you read the word, every time the enemy comes to afflict you, what he checks is your word there. Every time the enemy comes to afflict you, what he checks is
your word
there. Let's read quickly. It says, and it, what am I saying? No, as John 1:1-5, we're on verse 2. John 1:2, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was God himself. Nothing was made, verse 3, the same was in the beginning with God, verse 3, and all things were made by him, and without him, without the word of God was nothing that was made me.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Verse 4, it says, so the word of God has the creative ability to create things. The word of God has the creative ability to create all you need.
Amen.
You understand why your amen is not loud enough?
Amen.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men. So every time you fill yourself with the word of God, you don't let carry power, you don't let carry fire. You walk in the light. So you are a light yourself.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And he says, as you are going, you are the light. And this light shined in dark, and darkness comprehended it. You don't know what it means. If you put that light off now, there'll be darkness. Once you put the light on, darkness disappears. So if you fill yourself with the word of God, you are a light. And as you are walking by that same office that has rejected others that just came casually, as you enter there for no reason, the word of God just gives you a breakthrough.
Amen.
Amen. The word of God is quick and powerful. Hebrews 4:12. It is quick and powerful. It says it is sharper than a two-edged sword. For the word of God is what? It's quick and powerful, and is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul. That's why we say we can send a word from England, and in South Africa, someone is ill of cancer. Someone gets out of the ICU. Why? The word of God. It is quick and powerful. And sharper than any two-edged sword. It says, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. So as it goes, anything it sees, it eradicates. And the joints and the marrows and the bones, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intent of the heart. Sir, it is difficult to know the heart of man. You need the word of God to know the heart of man.
Yes, sir.
People can love you. A marine spirit literally can be around you for 10 years. Monitoring your life, gathering information. You wonder why everything fails. She's just there. After 10 years, you open your eyes and everything is gone. Before you realize, you can discern them by the word. There are people I don't just connect normally. I cannot. The spirit of discernment is so strong in me. I cannot connect normally because there is something that repels me from them. You know what? The word. Light and darkness have nothing in common. So when you carry light and you meet certain people in darkness, you cannot connect. Because light and dark, remember the word of God is the light that you carry. So every day you don't read your Bible, you miss. I even don't know how to tell you what you miss. Me, I made this week, I made up my mind. I said, Lord, I want to read the whole Testament, the whole New Testament before the day first. There's not just reading and meditating. Took me about 2 hours yesterday to read Daniel chapter 1 to verse 4. Yeah. So I'm reading. So is this what Daniel did? You see the courage of a man, and that's what put faith in you. That's why I can say something and go to sleep like a baby. You know why? The world comes with fire. Shout
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I said that the last time you lost shall be the last time you will ever lose in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Whatever has been a challenge after this word, it bows in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your amen is standing on one leg.
Amen.
Sit down, please. I'm very quick. We have about 7 minutes to go. Hebrews 3:7-11. Hebrews 3:7. I want just to show you something about the world. It's so short. And we go. Hebrews 3:7-11. It says, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, let's read together. 3, 2, 1, let's read. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation. In the day of temptation in the wilderness. It says, when your fathers tempted me, it says, prove me and saw my works 40 years. Verse 10, it says, wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter in my rest. Sir, you know, so much rest. The rest that God gives you through his word, you cannot swap it for 1 billion.
Never.
You cannot swap it for the president of a nation. You cannot swap it for, I'm telling you, for anything. Peace like a river. Said, I'll give you peace that exceeded all understanding. People come to me and say, Papa, this one just left. This one just left. I said, pray for them. And they want it. So you are not bothered. I said, well, I did not bring them in. God brought them in. So God can take care of that as well. You know why? Rest.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Rest via the word of God. Every time you fill your heart, your mind, your spirit, your soul with the word of God, if you go for an interview and you see people that are more qualified, you are just praying in tongues. You know why? Because the word in you gives you life, it gives you hope, it gives you joy, it gives you peace. Faith coming by
hearing,
and hearing by it. Call me even when I'm sleeping and I say someone just died. If I have time, I'll say, give them my number. I'm not saying that in my authority. I'm not saying that because I can speak and it happened. I'm saying that because he that is in me is greater than any sickness in the world. Know he that is in me, the word of truth. Sanctify them by their truth. The truth is the word. You know why you're still afraid of things? Because you don't have the word there. Someone say, you will die, oh, and you are just shaking. Pastor, they just threatened me. For I said, ye are gods, that ye know not. He said, you walk like men. When God is looking at you from heaven, and he's saying that this is a landlord of heaven, you are walking like a tenant. You see, thinking where the rent is going to come from. You know why? No word there. I will say it again and again and again. You are looking at a quadrillion. Yeah. You jealous? Yeah. You know why? Because when you read the word of God every day, now most of the things I hear is by a word.
Yes, sir.
Every time I have my Bible, I have a book and a pen.
Amen.
As you are reading the Bible, and that's how you can hear God easily. Unknown to you, just start showing you things. Start showing you things. And you'll be surprised that as you keep doing that, you begin to hear God clearly.
Yes.
You want to hear God clearly?
Yes.
Fill yourself with the word of God.
Yes.
Because the word is God himself.
Yes.
The more of him you have in you, the more of him you can hear.
Yes.
The word is so powerful. You want grace? Please go for the word. Prophecy will fail. Say, prophecy will
fail.
What does it fail? The word of God. He says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word remains forever. My word. Don't eat any food until you have read his word.
Yes, sir.
Don't drink water until you have read his word. You are putting life in you, man. Say, I'll lose my job. I just laugh. Oh, lose job. Why? The word of truth. So I swear in my wrath that they shall not enter. They shall not enter because they have refused to look at my word. All what they need to make their ends meet is all in my word. And as long as they have not opened that book, they'll keep going in cycles. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Peace like a river. You slap me on this side as a pastor. That's why you see me, I am extremely humble. You know why? It doesn't cost me anything. You say, take money to buy me sugar. It doesn't cost me anything. You want me to buy you sugar? Buy me sugar. Hallelujah. Now, I'm not saying this to mock anyone. I'm just giving an example. I will not even know what I'm talking about. Hallelujah. But I'm just giving, this is how we learn. I'm just giving an example. When you have the word of you know, sir, that you brought nothing in this world, and for sure you'll leave this world with nothing. So worldly things, they become normal. They become. And so what? They gave me a plane and so on. Money loses value to you. Money, when you have the word of truth, money loses value to you. When you have the word of truth, you are more engaged in helping others than helping yourself.
It's true.
My wife said, the only thing you will not sell, you'll soon sell, is me and the children. You see why people are still fighting? Because they don't have the word of God.
Amen.
I gave you 1,000 bucks last month, you need to give me this, and you are fighting. Who is fighting her? The way you have the word of truth. You know for a fact that he can handle that. Because you have him in you. You have him, so he can handle it. And you go to bed. A lady called me and said, Pastor, someone has been owing money for 2 years, thousands of pounds. And he said, the person has not been talking to me for about 2 years. And I said, don't worry. I cannot help you, but God can help you. And we pray a simple prayer. We say, don't worry. In 91 hours, you'll see. And behold, the guy did not call her. He transferred the money. You know what happened? An angel heard the prayer, the voice, and went and troubled him, sir. See, if a man ways are good with the Lord, what happened? Even his enemy shall be at peace with him. She called and said, Pastor, I don't believe it. He did not even call me. So indirectly, he called the husband to take her account number. So an angel troubled him throughout the night, and he was even afraid to call her.
Hey!
When you have the word of God, you walk with audacity.
Yes.
Let me come here and see three people. It does not change my preaching. You know why? I've seen it where I'm going.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter what happens, I know that my Redeemer is there. He's taking me there, sir.
Yes, sir.
He's taking me there. If you have a spare tire in your boot and your car breaks down in Birmingham and you're going to London, will you worry? You just will stand up and take it. The spare tire is like a word. Just replace the tire. You're off your road again. But if you don't have a spare tire, and you don't have AA or RAC, you're in trouble. Only the worry alone will destabilize you. You know what? Because you don't have any backup. The word of God makes you stand tall in the midst of adversaries. The word of God makes you stand tall in the midst of adversaries. Go to the hospital, they give you a medical report, say you have cancer. Because Pastor, they just said I had cancer. And you took it home to go and frame it and put it on your wall. Something is wrong with that picture. You are meant to stand up and say, not me. For in the beginning he said, by the stripes of Jesus I was healed more than 2,000 years ago. I was healed. They said I had hemorrhage. You know what's hemorrhage? That was about how many years ago? 7 years ago. And I was so afraid because I've been to all the physicians and they said, you know what? This is packing up. We'll send you to a last one in Birmingham. This is an expert. And if you can do nothing about it, then make your will. It's time to go. I said, I began to call my wife and say, this is the story they gave me. Then I was a boy. It's not a man. If you have a man who comes to you and say, I've lost my job, daddy, I've lost my job, you just call yourself a boy. And I gave my life to Christ. I fell in love with Jesus. Look at how they are not shouting. And that's the best part of the story. And I read in the Bible, it said, none shall be sick. I began to meditate on the word. I said, Lord, you said none shall be sick. I did not go to the pastor. Because even the pastor had his own things that are worrying him. And I knew. And I began to embark on that word of God. Lord, you said that no sickness shall stay in this body. You said my body is a temple. That's what it is. By his stripes you were healed more than 2,000 years ago. Sir, that's a prophecy. But it requires a man to stand up and say, I take my healing by force. Some of you, they give you prophecy, and you go and sleep and you are snoring. Say,
Never.
You know, it got to a point where, because people are very funny, you give them 5 prophecy, 4 happens, it happens speedily. Well, the one that is delayed, you will not sleep. You will not sleep. They will best you. Pastor, I see when nothing happened. I said, I've already spoken, I'm not speaking. They will bless you 1 a.m. They are calling you. 5-6 times they are calling you. You know why? Because they don't have their word. When I give you a prophecy, that's a word that has come to you. You take that word, you meditate on that word, and you speak it out. You put God in remembrance. The Lord, your servant has spoken. Let it be so. Now don't get me wrong, some prophecies will take time. He gave me an example during the marriage counseling. Some prophecies will take time because God is trying to build your capacity to meet up with the results of the prophecy. If I say you are a millionaire, sir, he will not give it to you now. He will not give it to you now. You know why? Because if he's giving 10 million now, he might not give it yet. He will tell me, Papa, I just had a business contract. I am going for that business contract. We'll see me here now. Immigration break to the next thing, your job is better than God. The next thing, that child God gave you is better than God. God can wait. In my spare time, I will serve him. If I gave my life to Christ in this generation, I'm sure I will show backslide. You know why? People don't remember what God did for them. Let's read Regadin, verse 11. It says, so I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Verse 12. It says what? Take heed, brethren. Let's read together. 3, 2, 1, go. Verse 12. So when they don't want to hear, many people come to church with their syllables. I've said that before. So when they come to a place like this, where what you are teaching does not correspond to their doctrine, they are in a hurry to go. Take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. They want to go where they are comfortable in their sin. They want to go where they will not tell them that that man you are staying with, that they are comfortable, where they don't touch that area of their life that is very sensitive.
That's right.
You see that, church? I'm not going there. You know why? Because every time they came, something reacted in them. Let's read the next one. It says, verse 30, but exhort one another daily why it is called. This is what I'm doing today. Exhort one another. Teach each other. That's the conversation God wants to have with each other. Teach each other the word. Exhort one another. Encourage one another in the word, in the things of the kingdom. Verse 14. It says, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. That means when the word of God is not in your life, sins get in rapidly. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When the word of God is not in your life, what happens? Sin gets in rapidly. Verse 14. It says, for we are made partakers of Christ. It says, if we hold the beginning of our confidence. Look at that. If you hold what? The beginning of our confidence. Steadfast unto the end. Why it is said, today if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. As I'm talking at some people, their spirit is at home, their flesh is in church. Pastor, you wasted so many times, so much time. It's not like they have something to do. As soon as they go out there, they'll be on their phone for 3 hours. And you will not bother them. You know what's happened there? The devil is manipulating them out of his presence. The presence becomes an irritation. So if the presence of God can become an irritation on earth, when you go to heaven, where will you be? The place will look so strange to you. Because you are not used to this kind of heaven, spiritual. So you get used to the presence now. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's read the next verse, and it says, today if you hear his voice, harden not your heart, as in the provocation of verse 16, for some when they had heard did provoke. How be it? Not all that came out of Egypt by Moses, but whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that are seen, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? And to whom, verse 18, swore he that they should not enter into his rest? But to them that believe not. Again, the word. If the word is not in your life, your faith will die. That's what it means. If the word of God is not in your life, your faith will die. That's why you see some people mourn and they cry. Because the word is not in them. Because when the word of God is in your life and they bring bad news to you, over to you, Holy Spirit. And you sleep like a baby. You know what? He says, verse 19, so if we see that they could not enter in because of what? Unbelief. Unbelief is as a result of your lack of the word of God. Now, we have not got to the level where we are supposed to be. Let me put it that way, because the enemy is fighting what is fighting. But guess what? God is really giving me the plan for the next 10 years. You know why? Because I've made up my mind that it must come to pass. Abraham staggered not in unbelief. Every day he wake up and said, if today is not my day of testimony, tomorrow will surely be.
Amen.
Hebrews 4:6-12. Seeing therefore, it remained that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached enter not in because of unbelief. Again, he limited a certain day, saying to David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. For if Jesus has given them rest, then will he not afterward have spoken of another day? Then remained, verse 9, therefore a rest to his people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own work.
Hallelujah.
When you cease from your own work, worry disappears.
Yes, sir.
When you cease from your own work, disappointment is just so normal.
Amen.
You know that the disappointment is actually working for your good. You know that the mess, there is a miracle that awaits you.
Amen.
Verse 10 says, for he that is entered into his rest, he has also ceased from his works, as God did from him. Verse 11, he says, let us therefore labor. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. So these verses tells you the importance of filling our spirit daily with the word of God. Without the word of God, we all sink. Without the word of God, we all sink. Without the word of God, Word and Fire Ministry will
sink.
Last week we said that until we see walking and seeking God as a privilege, it will not be exciting. And we cannot receive the full blessing. We said that Prophet Isaiah was available, but then God said, who shall I send? So that's the worst thing to happen to a man. That you are there and your family members are asking, and you are the first son. They're asking, who will come and pray for us? And you are there. That your presence is felt in your absence. Understanding or understanding anyhow. That someone probably, they had to make a major decision in the family, they don't tell you. It is after they tell you that, you didn't know what happened. You know why? Because you are not very important to them. After now, you'll be celebrated in the name of Jesus. I don't like that amen at all.
Amen.
I don't like that amen at all.
Amen.
I say I reconnect your relationship with God in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's stand up and just thank God. We're out of the time. I've already started my message. We're out of the time. Thank God. Thank Master Jesus. Thank Master Jesus. Thank Master Jesus. Father, we thank you, Lord. We celebrate you, Lord. We rejoice you, Lord. We honor you. We adore you. Thank you. If that is all you've learned today, please go home and apply. The word of God is the power of God. The word of God is the blessings of God. The word of God is the miracle you are looking for. The word of God is all you need to make your ends meet. Open your mouth and thank him. Maso parie katala. Lekete maye kote maya kata. Lekete maya kata. Leko kote ya kata. Maso parie katala kata. Lekete maye la kata la kata. Father, we
Jesus, we Lord, we Holy Spirit, we
in Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Any manipulation, whatsoever,
that stops me from reading your word,
that stops me from sitting at your feet,
no matter their rank,
from sitting at your feet, from reading and meditating on your word. Jehovah God, you are a consuming fire. Consume them now. I give them fire. May they scatter and die now in the name of Jesus. You
Between the two people I just spoke to, you and her, is there any twins in your family at all? The way I just look up, give her the mic. Is there any twins in your family as well?
Yeah,
there's twins, right? Is there any twins in your family? I see that connection. Who is Nuella? One of you.
Nuella is my big sister daughter.
Okay. Hallelujah. Yeah. I see something that I'll pray for you later on. Do you know Apolline? Who's Apolline to you? Okay. Does he do business? What does he do?
He works in Dubai.
Does he do business? No. What does he do? What kind of work does he do?
He's a security guard in Dubai.
I saw him opening a security company. That's what I wanted to say. Tell him to go and lay his hand on how to open a security company. Once he does that, his doors are open.
Yeah.
Which habits?
I've always told him that.
You always told him that? Hallelujah. Clap for Jesus. Clap for Jesus.
Is Yannick? Yannick is the husband of my small sister.
Yeah. What do you have to do with Yannick? Do you communicate with Yannick?
Yeah. No,
I see contention, that's why I'm asking that.
Yeah.
I see. Yannick doesn't like you. Yannick doesn't like you. I see contention, but God is bringing peace in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Who is Sabine? Sabine.
It's my big sister.
Come.
Hallelujah.
Your mother. He's very worried about you guys as I speak to you. Hallelujah. Sabine. You've done so much for me. God is bringing a restoration in your family.
Amen.
God is bringing a restoration. I've not seen your father.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But I see someone in an altar doing, I see curries. Do you have a doctor, a traditional doctor in your family? A doctor, Matthews, Ariel, Matthews, yeah. What's his name?
Matthews.
Matthews. I'll tell you something, I didn't say that. I see him using carries, I see him using things, but the things he's using, some people are thinking that he's using them for protection. But those things are used to afflict. There is no good part of evil. There's no nothing good about
evil.
Take D, you still have evil. There is no good part of evil. Tell your mother you met a prophet. And a prophet said, God is bringing her help in the name of Jesus. God is bringing her help in the name of Jesus. God is bringing her help in the name of Jesus. If you are the one I'm talking, a prophecy for one is a prophecy for all. If you need the help of God, take it in the name of Jesus. Take it in the name of Jesus. Take it in the name of Jesus. Take it in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Sabine. Now, this is prophecy I'm giving. That's why I don't prophecy. Me, I want to preach my word and go. Because you are talking, now people go to sleep. Instead of praying about it. Now, I'm saying I see. I did not say God is saying. I see by February 2020, a miracle is coming to happen. a miracle is coming to her. What is February for you? I see altars connected. Your real problem, someone is hitting their chest. From February 2012, someone is hitting their chest. Say, I have vowed that they will not get married. Say, but as they are married, let them go anywhere, they'll come back empty. The Bible says, who is it that said, coming to pass when God Himself commanded enough? By the power of the Holy Ghost, I decree a 91 hour judgment. And whoever has vowed that this marriage will not go ahead in the name of Jesus. They use leaves, they use birds, they use sacrifices against your marriage, against your promise. Let those tariffs backfire in the name of Jesus. Let those tariffs backfire in the name of Jesus. Sabine, I see two children and one. What is that? How many children does she have? Does she have any other child? Another child is coming. Hallelujah. Another child is coming in the name of Jesus. But I'll tell you something in your ears. Oh, I'll tell you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Who is a vote
for? Hallelujah.
Wait, when I speak like that, even when I told you, I still, I don't know where I told you. But you have to understand that God sees the end from the beginning. Any of you are saying, I can't hear another child. I say, no, me. God sees the end from the beginning. Habis. You know anything like that?
Habiba.
But she's called Habis. I see somewhere in America.
Amen.
I enter the house. I see Delaware. Do they have a charming?
Yeah, they live in Delaware.
How many children have they got?
Three.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
As I'm talking to you now, I see it's like, I don't know how you call it, snail. Snail. You know snail?
Yes.
I see snail. I see two snails on your forehead. This is not the prophecy of doom. That's what I'm seeing. I did not say God said. I see. I see one very big one. I see another small one. And I'm asking God, what is this? And He says, this is a snail anointing that has been released to slow down your movements. Which are elo. Someone in your family who is doing some technical thing. Technical. Elo, like A-A-A-L-O. I think Eloma.
Oh, Aloma.
Hey. Who's that?
That's my cousin.
I see a breakthrough job for him.
Yeah.
And that's now a prayer point.
Yes.
Many times I'll say that God, and it happens, we heard it, testimonies here. But sometimes there must be someone who must activate. Yes. It's called walking of miracles. Walking of?
Miracles.
So someone must walk there?
Miracles.
Many times.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Bless your right hand and say, oh Lord.
Oh Lord.
Whatever it is that I need before the end of this year. Anyway it is, let it come that speedily. 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 Yaso paye katara. Lekekete. Aso paye katara. Lekekete mayala kata. La sopa lie katara, le kekete, ya sopa lie katara, ma tekete, a are you praying? Pray. Angels are here now. Let's go, Paria. Let it come to me. Cynthia, come. Cynthia, lead up and come here. Yes, oh, Paria, Tata. Pray. Anything that needs to enter my home before the end of this year, wherever it is, I call it for. 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 Lion of the tribe of Judah. 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 Pray. Anything that needs to enter my hand, you yourself pray. Let it enter my hand. Let it enter my hand. I see no miracle. That's why I call you. Maso paye katara. Leko kotere ketere ketere. Yaso paye katara. Anything that is stopping my ministry, let it break in the name of Jesus. Bring it here. Let it break in the name of Jesus. Yes, so Padre Katala. Mako Kote Rekete. Leko Kote Maria Kata. Leke Kete Rekete Rekete. Masala Kote Maria Katala Kata. Leko Kote Re. Whatever has left you, I command it to power. I command it to power. Lose your arm in the name of Jesus. Thank you, my Father. 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 Take speed in the name of Jesus. Take speed in the name of Jesus. Take speed in the name of Jesus. Let me release now. Thank you, Jesus, in this song. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Let's thank God for answer prayers. Father, we thank you for answer prayers. Lion of the tribe of Judah, we thank you for answer prayers. Jesus, Son of David, we thank you for answer prayers. In Jesus' name we are praying. Amen. I see you in the children's department. I see you driving the bus. Maybe I've been thinking about what you're doing. That's what God is telling me. I know you're a teacher, but she has not anything to do with teaching.
Yes.
Has she done before?
Yes.
I see you teaching. Hallelujah. Amen. I'll pray for you, I'll call you, and then we'll do a fast, and then we'll pray. Hallelujah. Then tell your mom that something is coming behind the name of Jesus. I don't like your amen at all. Let's thank God. Are we still having a workers' meeting? We'll postpone again. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you. Thank you. Lion of the tribe of Judah, we thank you. Lion of the tribe of Judah, who is Gael? Something like Gael. Yeah. I don't know what is that, but that's what. Just tango. Eh? Okay, it's your daughter. No, but I see you connected to her as well. Let's thank God. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we bless you. Lord, we love the time. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we rejoice you. We honor you. What is honoring sick of? What is our problem?
Nayo is honoring daughter.
Okay. Okay. How long has she been sick?
So many years.
What did the doctor say? Because I see a coffin, not for her. It's not going to happen for her, okay? I see a coffin. That's what made me, when I was talking, I said that. And God said to me, pray for honoring. Whatever it is that affliction by the power of the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. Right now, I release 100 legions of angels. Let angels of healing go forth now. I declare, let her be healed in the name of Jesus. Wherever they are holding any part of my body, I stand in the authority of the word. I command them to lose her in the name of Jesus. Let there be a miracle in the name of Jesus. name we have prayed. Let us share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ.